Thanks for joining me. Hey, do you ever have a layer that's so dense and overlapping and stacked up that you can't make any visual sense? Certainly no quantitative sense out of it. I'm gonna show you how to make a tessellation. And into that tessellation, we'll pour a few cool visualization options. This video is brought to you by Dr. Bin Lee, professor of geography at Central Michigan University. More on that at the end of the video. Here is the lovely Midwest. And here is a few days of flight data. Oh my, let's zoom in. Maybe we can break this up. It's pretty dense. Oh shoot. How can we take data that's so dense and highly overlapping and actually make some quantitative sense out of it? Well, you might initially be tempted to say, well, I'll just handle this via transparency. So I'll open the symbology panel and instead of 100% opaque, I'll make it 90% transparent, 10% opaque. Actually, this is really useful from a visual perspective, but I'm still sort of stuck from a quantitative perspective. There's no way for me to grab a little area and say, how many flights went overhead in a certain amount of time? Or is there? Behold, the hexagon, nature's favorite shape. Let's create a honeycomb layer in ArcGIS Pro, and then we'll pack our data into that where we can do some quantitative doodads. From the analysis tab, I'll open the tools, and I'm gonna search for an amazing tool called Generate Tessellation. What's a tessellation though? A tessellation just means you're tiling a floor and each tile has to be the same size and the same shape and there can't be any gaps. Well, you might be thinking, hey, John, I just heard you say same size. We better check what projection we're using on this map. Darn right. Let's open up the properties for this projection. Coordinate system. Oh no, we're using Web Mercator. That means a tile here would be a much different area than a tile down here. Even if they appeared to be the same size on this projection, they're not the same size in real life. So we need to use an equal area projection if we're gonna make a tessellation layer. And I've got one right here, Elber's equal area conic. Okay. For the extent of our new tiled floor, I'm gonna choose the current display extent, which is just, you know, what I'm seeing on my screen here. And instead of a hexagon, wait, I thought this was about hexagons. Yeah, it's about even cooler hexagons, a transverse hexagon. Transverse just means pointy sides up and down instead of sideways. It's the cool way. What about size? This is a little bit of a Goldilocks give or take experimental phase. I'm gonna try square kilometers and I'll make it 100 square kilometers. If this turns out to be too big or too small, I'll just tweak it. Let's see what we get. Very interesting. Let me make this a little clearer. Okay, this size looks pretty good to me. I can see little metropolitan areas around these major cities and track with the flight lines. It's not too small, it's not too big. It's kind of a weird balancing act. Now that I've got my lusciously equal area hexagonal tessellation layer, how do I use this as a cookie cutter to add up how much overhead air traffic there is in any one little 100 kilometer space? We are going to use the magic of spatial join. You're probably familiar with a table join, which uses two common attributes to smush together different tables. But a spatial join uses location. Bananas! The target features are the destination shapes that you want to use in your result. And we'll use our hexagonal tessellation here. The join features are the data that you want to steal to put into the target features. And for that, I'll choose flights. I'll give it a good name. A join operation of 1-to-1 is fine. You can look at the details here, but I've effectively always used 1-to-1. I'm gonna keep all the target features. That means if a hexagon exists that no flight line has passed over, I still wanna keep it in my output with a count of 0. The spatial relationship. There are so many interesting options here. I'm just gonna choose intersect, but give each one of these a look. If you check out this metadata, there's a little description of each one. It's fascinating. Let's run it.
1 minute later.
Now I can turn off my flights and my original hexagonal tessellation, and now I have the same shapes, except if I look at the attribute table, I have a count of all the flights that went overhead within each shape. This is great. We can do something with data. But what? Let's break out the crayons and goof around with some symbology options. I'll open up my favorite panel, the symbology panel, and see what's available to me. Instead of single symbol, which makes everything look the same, let's paint with data. I'll choose graduated colors, and join count is the attribute that adds up all the flight lines that went overhead. So we're off to a good start. Natural breaks is almost never my favorite choice. I tend to lean toward quantile because it highlights visual variability within the data. It's good for non-normal data, highly skewed data. And instead of a color scheme that's kind of regimented like this, let's blow out the classes and just see what happens if 32 classes, and then just give it a smooth color scheme like, I don't know, this. Whoa, that's pretty. I've made another color scheme that's also kind of pretty. This one actually uses transparency within it too. So the more opaque and bright it is, the more traffic overhead. The more transparent it is, the less traffic. That makes sense. And it uses color and opacity. I like that kind of thing. Here's a look. On the end, add more transparency. I don't like, though, this default gray outline. How do I get rid of it and say have no outline around all these? Do I have to change all 32 of these symbols to have? No. In the more option, I'll choose format all the symbols at once, and it shows all the shared visual attributes of these symbols. In this case, it's line color and line thickness. I'm going to make this no color, and just to be sure, I'll give it a thickness of 0, and I'll hit apply. Now it's applied that to all of them. Or you could give it like a cool, neat, semi-transparent cyan outline, which I am wont to do. Sci-fi. But sometimes we'll see these hex maps that have a cool way of scaling the hexagon based on this underlying data. How do they do that? How do you scale a polygon? Well, instead of graduated colors, just choose graduated symbols. And ArcGIS Pro will place a marker symbol in the center of each polygon. In this case, it happens to be a fleshy circle, but we can change that. I'll dig into the template, and this little shape selector here, instead of a circle, I'm going to choose a hexagon, the same shape as the polygon that's containing them, and find rotation, and I'll just make this 90 degrees so it matches the cool orientation of our transverse hexagon shapes. Let's see what we've got now. We're getting somewhere. This is very cool. I'm going to get rid of that outline. We'll back out to our main symbology panel, and for this background option, it's just using, once again, that opaque mid-gray color. Let's give it a cool semi-transparent cyan. I like that. We'll go back. Have you noticed that some of these are overlapping each other? They're so big that they're blowing out the other. Let's add some more classes to get a little bit more nuance here. I don't know, 20 classes. What do I pay by the class? And then the maximum size I can tweak until they stop running into each other. That looks cool. And then I'll push this way back for the minimum size. And we've got this really neat newsprint style symbology showing overhead flight traffic. But I sort of miss my cool colors. Not in love with the fleshy tendrils coming out of Chicago. Can we add the visual dimension of color to this? Look at this little vary symbology by attribute tab. If I choose this, I can expand color. And I'm just going to point it to the same attribute, which is join count. And now it's color coding. It's using a not great color scheme, but you can make your own color scheme like this one. Now what happened? Well, because our data is so non-normal, Chicago's just blowing everything else out of the water. I can drag this max value, pull it way back to something more reasonable. And then we can just drag this to taste. Whatever adds the most visual clarity to the story that your map is trying to tell. Tell you what, let's get crazy. So far we've been doing a bunch of 2D stuff. Let's try hacking a 3D surface out of this data. I'm gonna turn this into a grayscale visualization. So I'll go back to graduated colors, quantile, all the classes, black to white. I'll open this more option and format all the symbols so I can give it no outline. And now I would like to share this and export the map as a GeoTIFF. So the file format is TIFF, and make sure that this write GeoTIFF tags option is selected so it knows where to live in geographic space. That's important. And here, color depth. I don't want it to be true color. That's red, green, and blue all mixing together. I want it to be grayscale. So I'll choose 8-bit grayscale. And then I'll increase this resolution a lot, say twice my screen resolution. So 3840 by 2160. Okay, it's ready. I'll turn everything off. Turn off this. Turn off this, and I'll add my layer. Looks about like I would expect. I'm gonna go to view. I'm gonna convert this to a local scene. 3D. this. Now, my image is here. I'm gonna put this as a ground layer. I'm gonna turn off my regular elevation service and bring this tessellation image as a ground surface. Now I can turn my imagery back on. And if I lay this flat, it's pretty flat because we only have 255 pixels of depth here. If I go to the appearance and multiply this by 100, let's see what happens. That happens. Let's multiply it by 500. Wow. Now we have a 3D surface driven by the amount of overhead flights that happen. And looking straight down shows you the imagery. And the result is a trippy sort of giant's causeway sort of map where the interactive base map renders perfectly on top of the little hexagonal tiles, kind of like a Qbert world. I mean, why not? This video was brought to you by Dr. Bin Lee of Central Michigan University. Dr. Bin Lee taught me at least half of what I know about geographic information systems. And he turned something that was at first pretty scary into something less scary, and then a little bit of fun, and then a lot of fun. Thank you, Dr. Lee.